Thank you very much. I'd like to say to begin with how much we appreciate those of us from Roebuck Parkway to be here with you today. Someone had said earlier, said, I hope that we make y'all feel welcome. And I honestly don't know anything this congregation could do to make us feel any more welcome than you have. You've provided a lot of encouragement to us by those that came out to knock doors with us. See how many people this morning are actively involved in this work this week. The food that we've been fed has been fantastic. As one preacher said one time, if you could go to heaven just based upon the food you fix, you've got a lock. You're there. But we do appreciate very, very much all that you've done in helping us out. Before we get into the lesson, one thing I do want to mention by way of explanation. Our minister, Jason Moon, was supposed to be here preaching this series of lessons. He had chosen out the lessons that he wanted to preach. And so when he was not able to come and they asked me to do it, the lessons I have are a little bit different. I know, I'm sorry about that, that the songs this morning were sung in reference to the cross. I'll be talking about the cross tonight. But this morning, I'm going to be talking about what I was supposed to have taught in the Bible school hour. And that is, what does the Bible say about the Bible? The Bible is the greatest book in all the world. The Bible has been printed into more languages, and more copies have been made, perhaps, than any other book in the entire history of the world. In 1969, when I was a senior at Freed Hardeman, the American Bible Society presented at that time to then-President Richard Nixon the 1 billionth copy of the Bible that they had printed. At that time, they were printing some 70 million copies of the Bible every year. Now, that's been 43 years ago. I didn't take time to do the math, but you multiply 70 million times 43 and see how many more Bibles they may have printed since that time. And then think that their American Bible Society is only one of 35 Bible societies in America. How many copies of the Bible there are in existence? There are enough copies that every individual in the world could have a copy of the Bible. There are just that many of them. And so God's Word has been given to us. We have an obligation, responsibility, as John talked about, to study that book. And this morning in our lesson, what we want to do, in this passage here in Psalms 19, verses 7 to 11, there are seven different things that the psalmist says about the Word of God that I want us to take note of. They're of extreme importance to us. Now, I hate doing that with seven topics because that just takes so long. So I'll try to go as fast as I can. Buckle your seat belts. Try to keep up with me and try to get through this. And if we don't, I will end on time regardless. But first of all, look at this, what he says in verse 7. He says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. I'm reading from the King James. I'd grown up with this, and that's what I'd done most of my memory work in. But notice, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. When we talk about perfect, in the Bible, the word perfect is used in two different senses. It's used in the sense of that which is without defect. There are no mistakes in it. And certainly that was true of the Bible as it was originally written. The autographs, the Bibles that came off the pens of those inspired men was totally without mistakes. Now today you'll hear people talk about, oh, the Bible has got thousands and thousands of mistakes in it. You know, there are all these different variant readings that you have of the Bible. Well, that sounds horrible to think that the Bible would have all that problems with it. But in reality, many times what they're talking about is there may be a variation in spelling. You see, I have the King James Version. And you look in the King James Version and you'll see words like honor, H-O-N-O-U-R. Color, C-O-L-O-U-R. But if you've got a newer translation, we don't use that spelling anymore. It's H-O-N-O-R, C-O-L-O-R. But every time a variation like that occurs, they say, you see, there's a mistake in the Bible, in the translation. There's some variation in it. And that's how they count up thousands of variations. But the Bible that God's given to us is a perfect book. It is without defect, at least the original autographs. There are mistakes that have crept in from time to time because of poor translations that are being made or copyists make mistakes. But what you have in your possession today is sufficient to give you all the information you need on how to become a child of God and how to live as God's child faithfully and live with Him eternally in heaven. But that word perfect also is used in the Bible to mean that which is mature or that which is complete. And certainly the Bible that we have today is God's complete revelation unto us. It has everything that we need in order to be able to live for God and serve God faithfully. John mentioned the passage this morning, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, where Peter says, according to the divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. God has given us in His Bible everything that you need to know that pertains to life, how you're to live your life pleasing to God, and to godliness. How can you be more like God? Everything you need is provided for you right here in this book. It's all we need. In the book of Jude, verse 3, we're told, "Beloved, when I gave diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith once for all delivered to the saints." Once for all times, God's revelation has been completed. And He has given us everything that we need, and it's provided for us here. God's Word is perfect. It's perfect because it's without defect. It is perfect because it is complete, giving us everything we need. And because of that, the psalmist says, because God's Word is perfect, it converts the soul. We need to understand and appreciate the fact that the power or the ability to convert a person, to change a person from a life of sin to a life of righteousness, is not found in the messenger. This poor preacher that stands before you has no power at all in him to convert anyone and to change them from a life of sin to a life of service to God. That power belongs in the Word of God, in the message that's preached. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, passage also mentioned earlier by John. Paul tells us there that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein, that is in the gospel, is the righteousness of God revealed. The righteousness of God is how God makes men righteous. When men do not submit to the righteousness of God and they try to establish their own righteousness, they can't be saved. The power to convert a person, the power to bring about a person being converted to God and living the way God wants to, is in the gospel. There is no other power that can do that. James chapter 1 and verse 21. James says, "Wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your soul." God's word is perfect, converting the soul. It can do it, and no other power can. Ephesians 1 and verse 3. "In whom also," Paul says, "ye trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after ye believed, ye were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit." Notice he calls it there the gospel of your salvation. This is it, friends. This book, the gospel of Christ, is the power of God to salvation. It provides for your salvation, and it's the only thing that will. God's Word is perfect, converting the soul. You look to one example in the book of Acts, chapter 2, when the gospel is preached for the first time. And when Peter preached that gospel, there were those in the audience whose hearts were pricked. How? The Word of God. The Word of God is the sword of spirit, and it pierced to the hearts of those people, so that they were convicted of sins, and they cried out in verse 37, saying, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" The Word of God told them what they needed to do. Peter replied to them in verse 38, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." The Word of God encouraged those people. The Bible tells us they exhorted them, "Save yourselves from this crooked generation." The Word of God gave to them the need, the message they needed to know in order how to be saved. And those people who received that Word were baptized, and God added them to the church. The Word of God's what does that. That's what converts it. So number one, the Word of God is perfect, he says, converting the soul. But number two, he also tells us there, the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. That little word sure that's used there is a word that means secure or lasting. God's Word is something that you can trust in today, and you can trust in tomorrow. You can trust in the next week. As long as you live, you'll always be able to trust in God's Word. It's sure. It's not going to change on you. One of the things about this life is that so much that people believe to be true and are dependent upon, too often we find later is proven to be wrong. And so things have to be changed. Think about ancient time. Now I'm talking about years and years ago. I'm not talking about last century. I'm talking about way on back. There were those people that believed that this world in which you and I are living was on the back of a giant turtle swimming in a vast ocean somewhere. But we don't believe that today. You know, through the years, men became wiser and knew more about it. And so in the 1400s, there were those who thought, you know, this world is flat. If you sail too far off of it, you're going to fall off and you'll die. Nobody believes that today. Nobody seriously. We know the earth is round. But you see, those things that men believed at one time changed. Look at the realm of medicine and see how much things have changed through the years. Our first president, George Washington, died primarily because of the fact that he was bled to death. You know, there were those people that believed, you know, that if you had some sickness, that what you needed to do was to bleed a person. And in bleeding that person, you're getting rid of the sickness as well. And so they would use things to bleed a person, maybe to cut into a vein, or maybe use other means of doing that. And they just kept bleeding and bleeding and bleeding until he died from it. But nobody believes today that that's the way you cure diseases, is by bleeding someone. I had a dear aunt of mine. She was a nurse. She passed away several years ago. But she had in her home a book on medicine. It was a book that was written either in the late 1800s or early 1900s. But it had all these cures for every kind of disease and all imaginable. And there were two of them that I remember most. One of them was the cure for the common cold. And the cure for the common cold involved a fedora, that's a hat, and a pint of whiskey. And what you did was you sat on the bed, you put your fedora down at the foot of the bed, and you sat at the head of the bed, and you would take a sip of whiskey. And every few minutes, you'd take a sip of whiskey, and you'd take a sip of whiskey. And when you could see two hats, your cold was gone. That was an honest belief there. Let me tell you about another one, sore throat. Now, this one interested me. I had a lot of sore throats growing up. And so you would take a strip of raw bacon, sprinkle it with pepper, wrap it around your neck, then use a sock to tie around it and hold it on there and spend the night, sleep through the night with that bacon around. And in the morning you wake up and your sore throat's going to be gone. Let me save you the trouble. I tried it. It doesn't work. You know, what people believed in the past, they don't believe today. Anybody who's a doctor will tell you through the year how medical books have changed. They'll tell you how all these different books of history and everything have had to change because there is no one book like that you can say, this is it. This is the absolute truth, and it's going to be proven to be the truth as long as this world stands. But the Bible is. God's Word is sure. It is secure. It is something we can depend upon. Psalms 119, verse 89, forever, O Lord, Thy Word is settled in heaven. That is, it stands firm. You don't have to worry about that. The Bible's not going to change, and you can depend upon it today and tomorrow and as long as you live. And because it's sure, he says that it makes wise the simple. James tells us if a man lacks wisdom, he's to pray to God, and God giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. If you need wisdom, you need to pray to God for it. But you don't just simply pray to God for wisdom, and then the next day you become a genius. We're taught we're to pray for our daily bread. But we have an obligation to get out and work for that bread. And Paul said, if a man will not work, neither let him eat. You can't pray for bread and then expect God to rain down manna for you like he did for the Jews in the wilderness. And in the same way, you can't pray to God for wisdom and expect God somehow is going to open up your brain and start pouring wisdom in. You're going to get that wisdom through this book. This Word of God is sure, and because it's sure, it gives wisdom unto people. It makes wise the simple. Let me read just a few verses from the Bible in regard to this. When Solomon wrote the book of Proverbs, and Solomon was considered to be the wisest man in the world of his day, he wrote and says, the Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding. So he's writing this book so that men could know wisdom and they could perceive understanding. And so he says to his sons, beginning in chapter 4, verses 1 to 7, hear ye children the instructions of a father and attend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine. Forsake you not my law, for I was my father's son, tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. He taught me also and said unto me, let thine heart retain my words. Keep my commandments and live. Get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not. Neither decline from the words of my mouth. Forsake her not, and she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. We need to pursue after wisdom. We need to study the will of God to know, because that's the only book that's going to give us that wisdom that we need. We're not talking about the earthly wisdom. We're talking about godly wisdom that comes to us from God. It comes to us through that Word. Let me give you one passage in regard to this very quickly that I think is extremely important to us. It helps us to understand that there is a relationship between the progress that a person makes in wisdom As you go and get wisdom, gain greater and greater, there's a progression there. But there's a relationship in that progression of wisdom with your progression in the Word of God. Let's look again to the book of Psalms now, where David is speaking. Psalms 119, verses 98 to 100. David says, "Thou through thy commandments hast made me wiser than mine enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I have understanding more than the ancients, because I keep thy precepts." You see the progression there? David says, first of all, I know more than my enemies. Why, David? What gives you more wisdom than your enemies? I have God's Word. I have greater knowledge than my enemies because they, not the enemies, but the Word of God that he's talked about, is with me. But then he says, not only am I wiser than my enemies, he says, I have gained more instruction than my teachers. I'm wiser than my teachers. How is that, David? Because you have God's Word? No, more than that. It's because I meditate on God's Word. I not only possess it, but I spend time with this book, reading it, meditating on it, thinking deeply about what God has said in this book. And because of that, I gain wisdom greater than my teachers. But then he goes a step further and he says, I have more wisdom than the ancients. And he's not just talking about those people that lived hundreds of years ago. He's talking about the fact that those who have the greatest wisdom, generally speaking, are those who are older people. Young people, that's why we need to listen to our parents. That's why God, when he established those to be leaders in his church, chose those men who were older. And one of the very names that they bear, the word elder, comes from the fact that they are older people who will have greater wisdom. But David says, I've gained more wisdom than the ancients. How'd you do that, David? Well, listen, I'm wiser than my enemies because I have God's Word. I'm wiser than my teachers because I meditate on God's Word. I'm wiser than the ancients. Why? Because I obey thy precepts. I am obedient to the will of God. As one progresses in his relationship with the Word of God, he progresses in his wisdom in life. And so the wise man David says here that the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Number three, the statutes of the Lord, he says, are right, rejoicing the heart. God's Word is right. It's correct. It's right as opposed to that which is false. It is real as opposed to that which is counterfeit in life. God's Word is that which we need, and that Word that we have from God, he says, can rejoice the heart. Having the Word of God can bring great joy to an individual in life. It's so important. Men see in life sometimes a choice, and John talked about choices, that men see a choice in life only between the playboy philosophy that seeks pleasure in life and what Hugh Hefner called the joy-killing, pleasure-destroying churches. Those aren't the only two choices for finding pleasure in life. God wants you as his child to be happy. God's desire is for you that you will know joy in your life. But you do not gain that happiness, you don't gain that joy by actively pursuing it. It just doesn't work that way. For example, have you ever had those times in your life where you knew I've got an important meeting tomorrow morning and I've got to be there at 8 o'clock, and so I'm going to have to get up by 6 o'clock to get ready and get everything set up and make it to my appointment. And so if I've got to get up at 6 o'clock, and I say I need at least 8 hours of sleep, so I've got to go to bed by 10. So you go to bed by 10 o'clock, you know, because I've got to get 8 hours of sleep, and pretty soon you roll over and you look at the clock and it's 10:15. I've lost 15. That's all right. That's just 15 minutes. But see, the more you get to thinking about it, the more anxious you become about it, it becomes harder to get to sleep because you're trying so desperately to get to sleep. The same thing's true with happiness. When we're actively pursuing after happiness, you're going to find it just recedes from you further and further. But when you will lose yourself in service to God and doing what God's Word teaches us to do, you're going to find happiness being brought to you in life. Again, let's listen to what God's Word says about some of these things. Proverbs chapter 8 and verse 32. Solomon says, "Now therefore, hearken unto me, O children, for blessed are they that keep my ways." Blessed, happy, some of the translations render that. That's the idea of it. The happy man, he says, is the one that keeps my ways. Chapter 8, verse 34. "Blessed is the man that heareth me, watching daily at my gates, waiting at the post of my doors." The person who will listen to God is the God that's going to be happy. Psalms 119, verse 1. "Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord." The blessed man, the happy man, is the man who walks in the law of the Lord. following what God has given to us and what we need to do in life. And when you come to the New Testament, listen to what our Lord said in regard to that happiness. John chapter 13 and verse 17. Jesus said, "If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them." If you know what God's Word says, and you do what God's Word says, you're obedient to God's Word, you're going to be happy. That's how you get happiness in life, not by pursuing it, but by losing yourself in service to God, doing what God tells you to do, and as a byproduct of your obedience to God, you're going to find joy and happiness in life. That's what God's Word does for us. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. Then fourthly, the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. God's Word is pure. It's unmixed. There's nothing else added to it. That's one sense of purity. But it's also pure in the sense that there is nothing defiled about the Word of God. God's Word is pure. If you add water to a gallon of milk, that milk may not be defiled, but yet it's not pure milk anymore because something else has been added to it. And it's the same way with the Word of God. If you add anything to God's Word, it's no longer pure. And so God's Word is pure, and we need to keep it that way. Several years ago, our brother Jerry Jenkins, who passed away two years this October, he had been invited to speak at a denominational church, and they told him, you know, "We're just doing this. We want to know what other religious groups believe, and we're not asking you to teach anything other than what you believe, but we've got some questions that they sent him. We want you to answer these questions." Here's what one of the questions was. "Do you believe that the Bible contains the Word of God? Do you believe that?" "I don't. I don't believe the Bible contains the Word of God. I believe the Bible is the Word of God." To say the Bible contains the Word of God implies it contains something else other than the Word of God. And you know there are countless thousands of people in our world that believe that about the Bible. There are those people who say that there is so much of the opinions of men in the Bible that you can't read a single verse in the Bible and say it has the authority of the all-holy God behind it. Because everything is mixed together. Opinions of men, Word of God, and you can't know which is which. That's a lie that comes from Satan. Because the psalmist here tells us that God's Word is pure. It is unmixed. It's undefiled. And because God's Word is pure, because it's undefiled, it's something that we can trust in. And because of it, he says, it enlightens the eyes. Now, there's no miraculous enlightenment today that comes to us from the Holy Spirit. There was a time there in the first century when God provided that miraculous enlightenment to his people. And he had made that promise to them that when they're delivered up to the enemies, you don't have to give thought to what you're going to say because it will be given you in that hour what you should speak. Jesus promised them, "I will give you a wisdom that your enemies will not be able to refute or deny." But there's no spiritual enlightenment like that today. No miraculous enlightenment. But we can have that enlightenment through the Word of God by doing what God's Word says. We can know. And we can trust in it to give us that enlightenment that we need. Psalms 119:105. "Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Number five. The judgments, he says, of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. God's Word is true. You remember when Jesus stood on trial before Pilate? And Jesus told Pilate that "I have come to testify unto the truth." And Pilate says, "What is truth?" Now men have argued that question before that time and since that time, arguing about what is true and what constitutes truth. And basically there are two ideas that men have about truth. First of all, there's what's called the correspondent theory of truth, in which says that truth is whatever corresponds to reality. If I made a statement, "It's raining outside," is that statement true or false? Well, just go outside and look. Is that what's really happening? If it is, then what I said is true. If that's not reality, what I said is false. That's the correspondent theory of truth. The other theory of truth is the coherent theory of truth. And that simply says that truth has to cohere with all known truth. If I make a statement and it is in disagreement with other known truth, then what I've said is false. Because it's going to have to cohere with all known truth. The Bible is true in both ways. What the Bible says corresponds to reality. That's what the reality of life is. And it does not contradict any other truth. I don't care whether you're talking about a truth of science, a truth of history. It doesn't matter. This book does not contradict truth, because this book is truth. And because this book here is the truth, because we have that from God, we know that we have that which is going to provide for our every spiritual need in life. Our Lord prayed in John 17, and verse 17, to His Father, and said to His Father, "Sanctify them through Thy truth. Thy word is truth." What does the Bible say about the Bible? The Bible says the Bible is truth. It's God's word, and we can trust in it. Number 6, God's word is to be desired more than gold, yea, than much fine gold. The finest of gold, the purest of gold, is not as valuable as the Word of God. Listen again to what the Word of God says. Proverbs chapter 8 and verse 10. "Receive my instructions and not silver, knowledge rather than choice gold." Solomon, the wisest man that ever lived, probably the richest man that ever lived. 666 talents of gold were brought into his kingdom every year. If a talent was 75 pounds, you multiply that by 12 troy ounces of gold, and then, oh man, you're talking about billions of dollars being brought into his kingdom every year. But Solomon is telling us, God's word is of greater value than the choices of gold. It doesn't matter how much it might be. And one of my favorite passages in all of the Bible is found here in the book of Job in regard to the Word of God. Job said in chapter 23 and verse 12, he says, "Neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips." Why? Because, he says, "I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food." Necessary food is the food you need to keep yourself alive. Now, y'all been feeding us so good. And when I got up and went back for seconds, that wasn't my necessary food. And when I made a trip to the dessert bar, that wasn't necessary food. I didn't need that to stay alive. But that was just a bonus. But Job's talking about the food that he needed to stay alive physically. You've got a choice, John. You've got a choice, Job says. You've got a choice between the food you need to live and the Word of God. Job, which do you choose? God's Word. "I have esteemed His Word more than my necessary food." Job would choose the Word of God. We need to realize the power and the beauty of God's Word and the importance that we need it. He says of God's Word, "It is sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Pleasant words are as in honeycomb, sweet to the soul and health to the bones." God's word is sweet to those who obey it, but it's bitter to those who disobey it. Revelation 10, 9 and 10, "And I went unto the angel and said unto him, Give me the little book. And he said unto me, Take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey." God's word is sweet to those who will obey it, but it's bitter to those who will disobey it. God's word is so valuable to us in life. Jesus said that we are to hunger and thirst after righteousness. That means that we would want righteousness through obedience to the gospel. We would want that more than we'd want food. If you're a hungry person and you're starving to death, what do you want most? Do you want food or do you want the Word of God? We need to have that desire for God's Word even above food necessary for our life. And then he tells us the end, that God's Word warns, and in keeping them there is great reward. Over and over again in the Bible talks about the possibilities, the dangers to our souls, and God warns us against it. Psalms 1 and verse 1, Proverbs 14, 12, Proverbs 13, 15, Proverbs 12, 15, 1 Corinthians 3, 3, Psalm 17, 4. All of those verses are talking about the warnings that come to us from God's Word. But he also tells us, in keeping God's Word, there is great reward. Yea, rather, Jesus said, "Blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it." John 8:51, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death." Matthew 19:17, "And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments." God's word warns us, but if we'll be obedient to that word, there'll be great reward for us. God's Word is perfect, converting the soul. God's Word is sure, making wise the simple. God's Word is right, rejoicing the heart. It is pure, enlightening the eyes. It is true and righteous. It is to be more desired than gold, yea, than fine gold. It is a source of warning and a meaning by which we can receive great rewards. But the question is, are we obedient to that Word? I wonder if there are some here in this audience this morning that perhaps never have rendered obedience to God's Word in becoming a child of God. And this book that God's given to us tells us that we need, first of all, to believe in Jesus as the Son of God, John 8:24. We need to repent of our sins, Luke 13:3-5. We need to confess Christ before men, Matthew 10:32, and be buried with Christ in baptism for the remission of sins, Acts 2:38. Having done that, we then need to live our lives in faithful obedience, even unto death, Revelation 2:10. If you haven't obeyed this Word in becoming God's child, or if as God's child you haven't remained faithful to Him, we encourage you this morning to make the correction you need. Become obedient to this one book, the Word of God, that can save your souls. If you're subject to this invitation, we encourage you to respond now to God's will while we stand and while we sing.